brothers, yeah. The Millie brothers, excuse me, which are both CODA CODs because they're CODAs, which means they're children of deaf adults. Now, both of their parents were deaf, no, but one of their parents was deaf. So you doesn't have to have both parents to be deaf to be a CODA. You can have one or the other or both. So they're called CODAs. And the reason why that often they grow up in feeling different, somehow feeling struggling with belonging and identity and find connection, meeting other children who have deaf parents. And they created CODA is for those who are adults who are 18 and older. KODA is titled Kids of Deaf Adults. And the other one is Child. So the KODA is 17 and younger. 18 and younger. So CODA CODA, when I mention the word CODA, I'm talking about both with a K and a C, all of them all together. So like I said, many of them struggle with an identity issue with saying I belong in the deaf world, I'm in the hearing world. They really have two types. Because in America, we have ASL and we have English, spoken English and ASL. So they go between two languages. And so they have two languages and two cultures, a deaf culture and a hearing culture within themselves. So the reason why, this CODA was established was to have resources for those who are CODAs, who need information, or to meet other CODAs, and to talk about struggles, or to just to connect and have a place to belong. And they have conferences. They have them internationally as well. So there is international CODA and the United States CODA. Now, KODA, on the other hand, has a camp. CODA has a conference. All right, well now, I'd like to start with our panelists. We have one of the panelists, I want to thank you all very much for coming. And I know that they're nervous, you know, but it's okay. We are nice people, right? Friendly faces, right? Okay, all right, okay. First of all, I would like to set up some rules. I would like you to, if your name or you're going to speak or sign, I'd like you to stand so the people in the back can see you. So first of all, I'd like you to, as individuals, for you to stand and introduce, say your name, your age, of course, Jay, your age is not a lie to you, but only those who are younger than you. He's a CODA, but he doesn't have to tell us his age, but if he wants to, he sure can. But anyway, I'd like you to say your name, your age, and what school you go to. Okay, those three things. All right, we'll start with you.
I'm 15 and I'm in 10th grade. I go to James Campbell High School.
Well, I don't think so. My name is KG and I'm like 14 and a half years old.
Well, yay. All right. Now, often, CODAs, they don't mind to say their age. Deaf people don't say, you're in the know who you are. That's not a question to answer, but in the deaf world, it's much different. I'm going to name your parents, and if your parents are here, I'd like your parents to stand, okay? Calvin's parents are Ed, Corey, Chico, you can stand, please. Kanji's parents, Aaron Idwe and Jonah Perino. If you could please stand. Marilyn's mom is Sherilyn Chong. Please stand. Brian Dakuyo Jr. His parents are Brian. I'm spelling the last name. I'm still learning Dakuyo and Senior. And Melia. Yes, please stand. And Jay's parents are Linda and Jeff Lambert. And if you both could please stand. Okay, well now, the next question I'd like to ask you is how do you communicate with your parents? Do you speak with them? Do you sign with them? Or do you have your own, say, private sign language that you use within at home? Is communication easy? Is it difficult? If you could explain your experience with that. We'll go ahead and start with that question. And anyone would like to start with that? Calvin, would you like to start with that?
Communication for me is really not that hard because I grew up learning sign language from my dad and my mom, and it came really easy for me. So, and since they're not completely deaf, they can hear, so I talk and sign with them, and it's really comfortable for me.
Okay, great.
So, communicating with my parents is starting to get much harder since kindergarten because I'm starting to get rusty. I had to learn two languages and kindergarten. Due to the fact my first language is not English, I had to repeat kindergarten.
Okay.
I learned to sign probably older in life because typically in a Kota family, if there is signing, the oldest child or the oldest daughter tends to be the strongest signer. And then the younger you get, the lesser your knowledge of sign is. So I didn't sign that great until I was maybe about 16. And then finally when I started volunteering at the deaf school, my dad was a lifeguard. Then my started signing music get better and picked up before that, back up to that. But before that, when I was younger, a lot of times I would sign to my parents, and my parents would be like, I know. And then when I met deaf people when I was older, I would sign only halfway, and they would be like, well, come on. And I'd be like, well, aren't you supposed to know what to say already? You know, because I got used to my parents just knowing what I'm going to say. So I can do it with the sign.
Okay. That's very interesting. We can see the different experiences with sign language, some spoken, some sign, some parents, you know, they have their own comfort level with each other. So, all right. I'm sure that you often get this question, and most common question, are your parents deaf? Wow. I mean, do your parents drive? And, like, how do your parents and you, you're hearing, how do your parents and you talk? You're like, oh my God, the same question again. Do you often get those questions? Could you explain maybe your experiences of when you get a question like that from someone? What are some common questions that people ask you? And how do you feel about that when you answer that question?
My friends really, most of them understood that my parents were deaf and they knew how to react to it. They were like, oh, okay, they're deaf. Oh, that's fine. They understood. They didn't do anything really to offend me or anything like that. But one of my friends was really not informed on how the deaf world works. So when he asked me, your parents are deaf? I was like, yeah. He said, oh, so where's your hearing aid? And then he said, I was like, why do I need a hearing aid? He said, don't you need a hearing aid to communicate with deaf people? I understood really because maybe he wasn't really informed on how deaf people communicate. I said, no, it's sign language. I really let them know how it works and then I give them.
Oh, wow, so interesting. I have never heard that before. Wow, first time. Well, thank you. Next, Kenji.
Honestly, I was like a little bit close back in the day. It was in elementary school. People have asked me that question. I was usually the shy person. So people did ask me, but they did talk about insults, but not about, but a little bit about deaf parents and stuff like that. But now, like 7th grade, you know, they usually don't care. But I usually like to tell to my close friends.
Oh wow, yeah.
I think one of the most important ones was before SAT, they wanted to know what A, B, C, D, E. You know why? Because that's the answers on the sheet. So we were like, A, B, E. We had a cheat. And of course, you know, they want to know the swear words. That's like the first thing. And I mean, I've heard all kinds of stuff like, do your parents read Braille? Can your parents drive? You know, all kinds of stuff like that. So, yeah, I mean, I've heard all kinds of stuff. But a lot of times it's a novelty. Like, they think, oh, cool, you can sign. And then they want to learn to sign. And then, like, after a day, it's like not a big deal anymore. So, that's been my experience.
Thank you. And yes, often those questions are very common, like, hey, teach me some swear words. I think that's something like why people are so fascinated with that, I have no idea. But if you as a hearing person found, say for example, if you talk to a person who speaks Japanese, they would the first thing you ask them, like, hey, can you teach me some swear words in Japanese?
No.
Oh, you will? Okay, maybe children do ask that. Okay, maybe it's similar. Okay, all right. All right, well. Now, okay, we have a deaf world and we have a hearing world, right? And a coda tends to be in the middle. Which do you tend to lean more towards? Do you feel more comfortable in a hearing world or in a deaf world, or are you kind of somewhere in between? And which one and why?
Well, I lean my face forward to the hearing world because I have more friends that are like more hearing.
That's really a tough question for me because obviously I was born and raised learning sign language, learning deaf culture and all this kind of stuff. But like Kenji said, my friends are hearing and I learned and spent most of my days playing with them, talking with them, hearing stuff, you know, all that kind of thing. But in the end, really, I feel more connected to the deaf world because that's where my roots really come from. I originated from that. And I, in the end, I'm really connected to the deaf world. Jokes about deaf people, not anything bad, but now that they know that, they use that sort of as a joke with one of them.
Okay, cool.
Growing up with my parents, I just started to believe that having their parents is normal. So whenever I meet new friends, I don't tell them until they find out, and I'm like, oh yeah, you know. I feel like the only time I actually inform someone that I'm an event is the office when they call up their house.
That many times where I had to introduce those two parts of myself at the same time. Now the one part that did happen, which came out to a bad result, was I was in fourth grade and at a birthday party, and all my friends had come over to our house, and my best friend at the time made fun of my parents, and I beat him up. I made his nose bleed, and he was on a trampoline. And I kept punching him, and he kept bouncing him back up. And then I got up, and we were no longer friends after that. So that's probably the only time that I've had those two worlds collide at the same time.
Wow. Okay. Well, I guess it really depends. Now, I guess it really depends on your personality as well. And it depends on their friends and what type of friends you have. Like, some friends might be like, oh yeah, that's cool, okay, sure. And some friends might be in shock, like, so what's it like having deaf parents? What did they say? Like, what's it like having deaf parents? What was your response to them if they say, what's it like having a deaf parent? What do you say? What do you mean, how would you say, like, oh, it's different? Or would you say, like, I don't know, normal?
I tell them all the same thing. It's not any different than having hearing parents, you know? It's only benefits, nothing wrong, you know? You learn a new language from it, you get to communicate easier, plus you get influenced in different cultures around Hawaii and all the places like that, so it's nothing but good.
Honestly, it's kind of a blessing / frustration not to have to work with. It's a blessing because I can learn language automatically, and I can listen to my music out loud in the car.
That parents means the car people rocking down the road. Okay.
And it's a frustration because I have to like switch between two languages and care about it. They used to, and back in elementary school, they used to like make jokes up on me. Probably got insulted. And the other was, and the real reason why it's a trouble for me because I had to repeat kindergarten back in 2008, 2007, 2008.
Yeah, so the struggle or frustration with school of having to repeat kindergarten. But now you're fine. You're good, right?
Yeah, even though I got more frustrated.
Oh, okay, cool. Well, then you'll be three languages, wow.
I would say is that any other family speaking a different language, like a Filipino family speaking Filipino and a Japanese family speaking Japanese, it's just speaking your family language. This is just the same.
I would probably tell that person, well, I don't know what it's like to be having a parent. never had any parents, I'm never going to have any parents, so it's sort of like I cannot kind of envision what a hearing parents would be like, and it's like they can't interpret how deaf parents would be like, so it's sort of like the mirror of the opposite.
Made us do things that could help us connect to our parents. Like there was a one day there where we could only sign there. We couldn't talk, we couldn't do anything. We had to sign just like as if we needed to use in the world back home.
Kenji?
Honestly, for camp, I thought only here, only in this island,
class.
Wow.
So it's like went to the east side of all the way to California. I just found out that not all people in Hawaii have deaf parents. And so it made me understand more about deaf culture. And it kind of teaches me how to like survive in the area as well. Since like a camp. And yeah, a lot of time and thoughts
that's in the United States or maybe a designated place in the world. So like this year's was in Vancouver. So I went to Vancouver this year and I met people from France, from Germany, from all over the world. Met a lot of Canadians. I've been to four different camps now. The first camp I ever went to was in New York City, New York State. And it's called Camp Mark 7. And that was about 15 years ago. And even though their code is just like us, culturally it's both very different way of talking, different ways of doing stuff. And then I moved on to Coda Midwest, which was in Wisconsin. Met a lot of Midwest people out there, and I met people from Michigan, Kansas, Minnesota, Illinois. So I met a whole different bunch of people. So I know people from the East Coast that are Codas and their parents, and Midwest people and their parents, and then I finally worked at the camp that they went to Coda West, and I mean, it's like each camp had their own way of doing things, which is great because I'm hoping to set up camps in different parts of the world and kind of, you know, structuring it so that culturally the camp will work. Because it's not, some things in America would not work in other places in the world. So I'm hoping by getting that experience from the different cultures that I can give them the information and they can mold the camp so that it fits the kids who are growing in different parts of the world. It's been an amazing journey, and it's amazing to see, especially campers, when they go to conference, you get to see them when they're young kids with pimples and anabolic days and stuff like that, and then become adults, and then they have jobs, and then they have kids, and you're like, wow, that's amazing. So it's always rewarding to watch these kids grow up and become K quota to C quotas. And it's I've seen kids come in like the first day, won't say anything, don't want to be there, and then the last day they're crying and don't want to go home, and you know, they just go on Facebook and Instagram and all that and just talk. And then school comes around and then they kinda drift back to the hearing world and wait for the next summer to come so they can see their friends again. So that's to me what conference is about. It's almost like Christmas every summer where I go see my Coda friends and then it's over and then I just don't want to let go and then it gets to December, January where it's about family and go back to work and you kind of drift away and then it's New Year's and you're like, okay, it's almost summer and then you're just building. I'm planning to go again and I'm going to go see my friends and we start talking more in May and June about, oh, I'm going to see you, you know, wherever the conference is and then or wherever the camp is, and then we see each other. It's like but every single year. So it's like Christmas in July.
Wow, cool. Christmas in July. That's really cool. Okay. Well, thank you very much, Quinlan, for your comments and participation. We're going to take a short break, about 5 minutes. Go ahead now. Remember, drink and eat outside of the cafeteria. And there are soda machines on the side here. So we'll see you in about 5 minutes. Not 15, not 10. We're not doing dev time today, so 5 minutes.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, hello, welcome back. I would like to introduce another panelist that has joined us. Okay, I'd like to introduce another panelist that has joined us. Susie, I'll let Susie explain a little bit about herself. And also, I've already asked if she could explain about, she has gone to Coda conferences for many, many times, way before your time, Jay. Anyway, just joking. But please welcome Susie. We just explained, everyone talked about, so if you're gonna sign, or stand up, we're gonna, as you make a comment, please stand up.
Hello.
Hi. I'm sorry for my weakness. I'm born and raised in California, Northern and Southern California and Venice Beach. And you know that area is kind of like the odd, strange area of people. That really kind of fits me too. Odd, strange. Okay, but you understand now more why I am the way I am. Anyway, born in Southern California, I moved a lot more and more to the South and ended up in the Bay Area of San Francisco. We're discussing, yes. Both of my parents are deaf. My mom and dad divorced, and a stepdad who was also deaf. Lots of deaf family around. My brothers and sisters, I had lots of them. All sign fluently. Not all interpreters, but all sign fluently. We're all hearing. I grew up in the deaf bowling alley, in the deaf club. I really enjoyed that. And Patty was talking about the deaf club, and I just enjoyed that. As I talked about CODA conferences that I've been to, the first one that I went was in 1980, and I sort of stayed in the back because it was sort of odd to me. I watched the people making comments, and people were crying and being emotional. I didn't really want to be part of that, so I kind of left. And then my friend says, you've got to go to CODA conference. You've got to go. I said, oh, well, I really want to go. But I came again, and for the first time, it really hit me. It was sort of like a missing puzzle piece that was a part of me that when I went into this hotel and I walked there and I felt like this piece that was missing from me automatically connected to me from somewhere, and I didn't really have to explain to the people in the room because all we had to say was like, oh, mother, father, deaf, yes. And we all understood each other, and we just have met, when we meet people for the first night, we maybe slept 4 or 5 hours, and maybe 3 hours. And the last night, we maybe slept 2 hours. And spent the whole time just talking and talking and talking, as Jay was saying, just holding on to every moment and getting everything that we could get from conversation and meeting people. And it was just a really wonderful experience. As Jay mentioned, there's CODA conferences. They have them in the East, in Florida, in the middle of the United States, in the West, and I think I've been to 5 or 6. I have not gone maybe 5 or 6 years since, but my first experience was really wonderful. My oldest sister, Judy, I said, oh, come on, she says, no, I don't want to go, I can't sign, I'm not an interpreter. I said, well, yes, I know you're not an interpreter, but if you go early, they have classes for people who are there for the first time. And so, I think it was in Denver at that time. And so we toured the city and came back and went to the hotel and saw all the people signing. Of course, she became frightened. I said, oh, I know you can't sign. So the first group that we attended, it was for first timers that come to the CODA conference, and I went with her for support. And all kind of just, scoping it out, becoming more comfortable with people. And then she just sort of left me. It's like, see, I told you, you just really would be fine, you'd be fine. And as people were telling their stories, and people were laughing so hard that they're crying, and they're passing out the pens to people. just, you know, because it's serious laughing. Woman was mentioned, she's like, I have no. My sister said, same thing, my mom signed the same thing, I have no. I signed better than her, or I as people kind of brag around each other. But you see the older sister go through, I've seen my older sister go through that. But my favorite part of CODA is the hospitality portion. We call it the hospital room. And even though it's this tiny little room out in the hallway and the small little room of any type that we have, we sit around there and chit chat and just tell stories and eat and have snacks and just talk. And it's really wonderful. I've learned a lot that you will find out that you are never alone, because growing up, you know that you might have brothers and sisters or friends who are out there that are seeing. That there sometimes they have no names. They have no names, but when I say I'm a CODA or you say you're a CODA, we know that we are not alone, that we understand our differences and why we're different. And I also like to add a little bit of a story about my name sign. My sister's Jerry. This is her name sign. Judy, as I mentioned. Mary. Debbie. Sandy, and then my name starts with Susie, but they gave me a K name sign. I thought, okay, I went through life without that, and one day didn't think about it, and I asked my mom, I said, hello, no, mom, hello. Everyone else has their name according to their first letter. Did you run out of S's or something, or did you run out of S placements? She looked at me, she says, what are you talking about? I said, my name sign is, okay, my mom's name is Peggy, with an F. Okay? Before she was married, that was her name. Your name is Susie with a K. Susie Call, together. K. So when I came and moved to Hawaii, I said, this is my same thing. I said, there's too many people that have a name here, K over here, K over there. So as an interpreter in Hawaii, they said, oh, you know the interpreter, the funny with the curly hair, always has the red lipstick? Yeah, that one. That's the interpreter. Susie Call. That's how I describe it. Curly hair with the red lipstick. Anyway, always have lipstick. At the beach, at the camp, wherever it goes, I have lipstick. Okay. So, it's good for you to, you can maybe pick a name sign for me. I don't know. Susie, but that's my name. So my mom gave me that name. So I had kind of funny stories, and my mom said, did you run out of S's or something? Anyway, all right. Well, thank you very much. Thank you. I would like Jay and Susie, as C CODAs, could you give some wisdom, words of wisdom or advice, maybe to other K CODAs or C CODAs that we have here in the audience or here on the panel? What would you say?
I kind of want to expand on the deaf world and the hearing world. Kind of expand on that. I kind of want to use like a metaphor. As imagine that some people that were fish, right? We're fish, and you have fish that spend their whole lives in salt water. And you have people who spend their whole lives in fresh water, and they never go into the other river. So you can spend your whole life on one side and the other, and not see the other. When we're little kids, we know both sides when we're little kids. But then, when going through life, you start to notice that when you're in the ocean, water's a little bit too salty. It doesn't match me. When you go into fresh water, there's not enough salt. I don't belong there either. So we spend our whole life wondering, well, I go to the ocean, doesn't fit. Go to the salt water, the fresh water, doesn't fit. So one day somebody came and said, hey, come, there's this brackish water there. A little bit ocean, a little bit fresh water. And you go in there, oh, I like this. This is kind of nice. I get a little bit of deaf, a little bit of hearing, this is nice. And then you realize, oh, this is a CODA part of me. There's three parts of me, not two. There's three. But it doesn't end there, because we're not all the same. We're not all the same. We have our own personalities. So maybe I belong a little bit on the saltwater side. Maybe I belong on the freshwater side. But you don't know that until you know the brackish part of the water. Once you've learned the brackish part of the water, then you kind of figure out, okay, I'm sort of in the middle now. I'm not all the way in the saltwater. I'm not all the way in the freshwater. I may be right down the middle. I may be a little bit to the salt side, a little bit to the freshwater side. But until you learn that brackish part of you, you're going to be wondering, well, I don't belong on this side. I don't belong on that side. Well, where do I belong? Who am I? Where? What am I supposed to do with my life? And that's why we want to introduce CODA to especially these kids. Get them to understand that there's a third part of you. You develop that third part of you, you get an understanding of who you are and where you belong, and then you can go into life going, okay, I'm deaf, I'm hearing, but I'm also a CODA. And now I can live my life. So that's my metaphor.
That's a very, really, really good point, Jay. I always felt that I was different. I became an interpreter for my family at age 9. I use language. My brothers, you know, my sisters, so we would go to school conferences, and I would go and listen and interpret, and I would come home, and I said, oh my, you know, you are such a troublemaker, oh my gosh. And nothing happened. I said, like, you are such a troublemaker. Like, oh, really? Okay. My mom would go, like, what's wrong with you? It's like, okay, he would be like, ready to get in trouble. Well, I've been just making it up. Anyway, so the power of that. The point is the power of language, right? I believe that I do a lot of reading. So language is really, really important to me. And I did not grow up with technology, no video phones, no TTYs, no technology. We did have light alarms in the house and vibrate things in the house to alarm people. We have to alert people in the room that there's in the family that people know what's going on. So when I would write letters, okay, and little, I remember writing letters to particular people, and we would have to drive to people's homes and sit there and wait and wait and wait for them to come. And my mom would talk, and we would play with the other, you know, other kids who were there. And that truly was something that I really enjoyed. And I don't know, like Jay says, I'm a CODA. I never knew that. Growing up, I knew I was a little bit different, that I transitioned from one world to the next. I tend to veer more towards the deaf than I did to the hearing. And when I realized that I could transition without disrespect and still respect my parents, that I understood that. And I felt more comfortable in doing that. And if you continue to meet, you know, older CODAs, or you go to another K CODA camp, I think it's a wonderful experience for you to grow, to become the next generation. So if you do go to your first conference, you'll be ready. You'll already have experience. You'll already know and walk in. And if you go to the camp, you'll feel very well prepared for that and meet other friends or other people. And your family of CODAs, or K CODAs and C CODAs, will grow. So you're very, very important. Thank you, Jay. Thank you, Susie. Okay, now I would like to ask you, K-CODAs, some of the parents of deaf also have hearing children, and some of them have not yet gone to a K-CODA camp. What would be your advice, or little words of advice or encouragement for the parents, or to have to send their kids to K-CODA camp?
Here's the
think that no matter if you want to go or not, for their parents talking about their kids, thinking like the kids are like, oh, I don't want to go, you know, I'm not going to find anyone there like me, I'm going to be different, I don't care. But I really think it's still overall just a good experience to go to any type of CODA camp, or because that camp is filled with people, no matter how much you think it's not, it's people pretty much just like you. Now, they have gone through the same things, they have experiences that may be the same or different than yours, and really, when you come together and you share that kind of stuff, it's really an equilibrium between everyone. It's something special, in my opinion.
Well, honestly, I would recommend for you to go there, but I don't take tears, so but I do recommend you go to the mainland because you see other people from different races, and you know when to like step out of your comfort spot, and you have to like deal with other people, like seeing the same people like every day, and so like and just not be bored with them later on. It's first like have fun with the other people from other places.
Question in one. Okay, so What is the specific noise that you just, the noise that your parents make that just annoys you? Okay, hold your noise, Susie. Hold your noise. Or the noise that you know that is, oh, that's my mom, my parents coming, because that's the only noise that my parents actually make. What is that noise that just like, oh my gosh? Secondly, and also, when you go to sleep at night, maybe you do sleep, okay. You know, sometimes parents either are cleaning or they're busy doing things around the house. Does that bother you? Is it noisy? Is that kind of noise that they make when they're being busy around the house when you're trying to sleep? I'm just kind of curious. I do make plenty noise.
I just hate when they just call my name because I feel like I'm in trouble even though I'm not in trouble. It's like a little... They don't really clean the house during nighttime. They know when their time limits are.
My mom has a bunch of bracelets, and I would hear that every day. My room is right next to the kitchen, so I just hear his food cooking and the microwave slamming. Whenever they knock on the door, they knock really, really loud. I think they wake up all the neighbors.
My dad doesn't talk. He rarely ever talks. But when my dad talks, we're in trouble. It's like, he makes that noise on the balls. That's bad. We gotta be serious. We can't play around anymore. We gotta be serious. So that was the noise that we all heard. That's not Matthew. You can keep going. Oh, that's Matthew. What's up?
Yeah, truly, I really like the pounding on the floor. I like that noise because my hands are really kind of connected to my foot. They're this way, but they both work synonymously. But anyway, that's one of my favorite things that I like. My mom always would drink coffee and stay up like all night long. She'd pound and stir the coffee cup. And she'd be like, I'd be like my room was right next door to the kitchen too. I'd be like, oh my gosh. I'd try to sleep. You pound on the table and then you clank, clank, clank the coffee cup. Always. But my mom is not here anymore. My mom's passed away. So I really miss that. I miss the deaf voice and telling story about calling my name. As you know, my dad would call, he would say this. You go, no, I don't want to go. I said, okay. He'd go. He's calling the dog. Okay, he just does this one sound all the time for everybody that he calls. I don't know whether he's calling you or he's calling the dog. My mom was different. My mom, Susie! So I would, when I would go to the store with my sister, was here in Hawaii with Linda, I don't know if you remember Linda Miller, my sister, we tend to go to the shopping together. I tend to wander off on my own, always. So I wandered off, my sister like, Susie, Susie, Susie. And my mom was there like, okay, come. You know the microphone in the store? I was wandering off, and it kind of made me kind of cringe. My mom called the microphone. My sister was so angry, she's like, I was mad, like, okay, hey, Susie, the microphone. It would make your whole skin cringe. Everything would just make your skin just jump up. And mom was on the microphone with everybody. Wow, okay.
My mom and dad, they can talk. They can talk for the most part. And my mom, for the most part, doesn't make too many noises that you think. But my dad is kind of different. When we're out, it's usually when we're out. We're doing something, and maybe he's talking to a clerk or an attendant, and then I'm off in the back, maybe just walking around looking at something, and then he needs help identifying or finding out what they're saying, so he looks at me, he's like, hey, go! And he yells, oh, he needs to come over there. And I'm like, that's pretty much the only thing. I really find it that since I'm connected most, I find myself most interacting with the hearing world. I obviously, whenever I dream, it's talking and it's hearing. But usually, it's more specific moments like this one. In fact, where I'm thinking like, oh, am I going to sign on stage or am I going to talk on stage? And I'm dreaming, how would I sign on stage if I need to? So it's moments like that.
I was dreaming and I thought I was deaf. about to walk up to my mom saying that I'm deaf now. But then she like looked at me and said something and that confirmed that I wasn't deaf.
Accidentally, out of nowhere, I just started signing, like, just a little bit, maybe in 2 months. And then I stopped. I'm like, oh, shit, I don't know. And then at the end of class, when I'm walking out, my teacher stops me at the door, and then she starts trying to sign to me, like. I was like, what? She's like, oh, I know some sign language. Oh. That was a long time.
asking them about my parents and their ethnicity and who they are. I just mentioned it that they're deaf. And whenever I presented, I always hear like a large gasp from the classroom. People would look at me and talk to each other and then smile and say, oh my god, that's so cool. And it just embarrasses me because I don't know how to get a really shit out of that person from everybody. And now that the attention's been all on me, I get more shy.
Not everyone has to answer. If you don't want to answer, that's fine. You don't have to answer the question. It's okay.
Okay, this recently happened. Now, Kai, you want to come up here? You want to or you don't want to? It's up to you. Yeah, come on. Come on. This is my son Kai. He's also a Coda. Okay, so about a week ago, he had an assignment from his class where he had to ask a grandparent about themselves. So, do you want to share what you asked grandpa or grandma about?
No. Say it there. Just say no. And you can leave.
Okay. Well, he just had to do it, so he's a little shy.
Okay, hold that up. Emilia, and then we'll go ahead, Emilia. Now, if you see yourself growing up and you date and maybe have a child, get married and have children, what if your child becomes deaf? What, like, wow, okay, I have to go, like, what am I going to do? Like, would you send them to deaf school? How would you handle that? How would you foresee yourself handling? Would you be excited that you have a deaf child, or how would you handle that?
Personally, I don't think it would be any kind of disability or anything bad if my child was deaf. I know for a fact my dad would be very happy that the child was deaf. And I think I would just try to, you know, get some advice from them, see what I could do to help them and nourish them, help them to become something like how they were, something successful.
Well, I do own a hard hearing dog. It was like kind of hard, but it would be probably the same for me as like I'm a child. It'll be like kind of hard to like train it, but I probably have to get some advice from my father. I got probably hire an interpreter, or sent to a deaf school. I don't know which result would be.
If my children turn out deaf, it's a good thing I know how. It would be good to ask my mom and dad for help to teach them the basic words and the basic spellings.
Trouble at school and had to interpret for your parent and kind of softened the blow a little bit, or maybe like made it less bad than it was. I'm probably going to get you in trouble now if you explain it, but I'm just curious.
My senior year of high school, I missed an entire month of school, and I thought I would interpret to get out of it, but my sister showed up.
I did have to interpret because they weren't able to interpret back all in Spanish, but I did get into trouble in that elementary school. And usually they send it by paper or email because it's a digital age. And trust me, it ain't pretty.
There was one time in 7th grade where my grades were dropping, and my teacher, she said that she's gonna call my parents if if I don't bring it up by Friday. So I told them that my parents are deaf and she's gonna have a hard time. The bad part was that a teacher in college, she learned sign language. So I got to bring it up on Friday.
Some of the problems were really common problems that we had within, just being a CODA and having deaf parents. Like, if you're trying to call your dad in public and then they don't respond, so you have to walk all the way across the store to tap them and be like this. Or say, there's, like I said before, a lot of deaf people have these deaf voices, so a lot of different people get to share their different parents' voices, so it's like how they yell and scream across different places, and everyone looks and they're like.
Well, I can add to that. Just like with hearing parents, you have parents out there who are very college level, can sign like nobody's business. And then there's parents who can barely sign, can barely communicate. And a lot of times you spend a lot of time protecting your parents. So if people insult your parents, you kind of stand up for them. And a lot of times you get into trouble because you are being aggressive. And everybody's like, why are you being all crazy? I'm just talking about your parents, And like I said, I beat up my best friend because he made fun of my parents. So. And it wasn't like something where I was a violent kid. No, it was just he said something and it affected me in a way where I had to defend my parents and I made him leave. That's basically what it comes down to. And like I said, because we grew up with a lot of deaf parents, we meet a lot of kids who are CODAs, but we don't know that we're CODAs. We don't go and say, hey, you know, what's up with your parents? Why are your parents angry? We didn't talk like that when we were little kids because it was not a big deal. And it wasn't until there was a concept of CODA and what it means that we are different that we started talking about our experiences. We never did that when we were kids because it wasn't something that mattered, you know? And so I think what happens is we all have these experiences and we can't share them with other people, so we keep them to ourselves. And because we keep it to ourselves, we learn to be alone. And we don't talk to people that in a way where we can connect. And until you start talking about yourself and opening it up to yourself, then you can open up to anybody you want to after that. I think we kind of get all these emotions and we kind of put ourselves in a little shell and we protect ourselves and we protect our parents and we protect the family. And until we kind of open that up, we're kind of stuck for a long time. And that's why when these kids go to camp, they can finally crack open the egg and all the emotions come out. And they can say whatever they want to say. They can finally express themselves in a way that they never could because they never had a chance to. So that's what I would say. I don't really remember. I just seen you red. I just read. Come on.
Yeah, but just like
Emily
said, you know, it's called the CODA machine. They would CODA buttons. They would just push all these CODA buttons. You know, we learned. When I was young, we set aside part of us that was our CODA feelings. We had to be interpreters and be interpreters and not have those. And sometimes we kind of tend to lean. If a person is maybe really rude or something, we have those emotions and feelings that sort of show themselves sometimes. So as same thing as Jay was saying, and a little girl in our neighborhood, and I thought she was copying my mom, but I got enraged and I started hitting her too. And I think, okay, now you're going to get punished. Your punishment is you're going to have to teach her sign language. So.
Well, I would like to say a relation to that coach. Because like all those elementary schools, I got bullied a lot. And I didn't realize until like fifth grade. And I turned red all the way up to the end of sixth grade. Because back then, I was like, no one's more respected than I'll make good. And I actually read it later.
Teaching me about deaf culture and bringing me to all these events such as this one, especially ones that are associated with deaf culture and other deaf people, of showing me different sides of different places, all these different people who talk and sign like this, and I learned all different types of sign language. And really what I, in the end, thankful for is that I'm unique in my own way, you know. In my school, there's no one else who has two deaf parents. Well, no one else who knows sign language. So, in the end, I feel like having deaf parents made me unique in that way.
Well, the thing about having deaf parents is, one, that's painfully obvious. Like my music out loud. two, I can just like look myself in the mirror to like say, having deaf parents is like a blessing to me more than a frustration. more that kind of frustration. And three is that I could learn like a second language immediately. Instead of taking like colleges and everything else like that.
Thank you so much.